A couple of just brief housekeeping things that we need to go over before we get started tonight. I know you all are waiting anxiously for Eric's presentation. If you're not a member, we'd love for you to join, and there's a form at the front door. We also have some postcards, brochures, and all sorts of other information. And so we'd love for you to join our museum and help us stay afloat.
Excuse me, who are you?
I wonder that sometimes, Lawrence. I'm Leslie Bolin. I'm the director of the museum.
Thank you,
Chris. I'm sorry. Doing a lot of things right now. Well, before I let you guys introduce Eric, which I wanted to remind you all that we have a lecture. We have a history lecture series, which is a part of our history lecture series, and we also have an industry lecture that we do on a quarterly basis. And the upcoming lecture is on the 20th, and the company is called DockWise, and it's going to be very interesting, and it's going to talk about the exploration of and production in shallow water, and we'll have a really interesting lecture talking about all the types of the vessels that are involved, and I think we'll learn a lot. I will learn a lot. It'll be very interesting. And all of our industry lectures have been. They're completely different from what we're doing tonight, but they're fascinating. So, about tonight, Eric Young is one of our treasured docents. We have a few of them here tonight, but he is our Friday docent, and he is at pinch hits whenever he can. And he's a wealth of information for us. It's a pleasure to have him here because whenever we don't know something, we immediately go ask him. And 99% of the time, he'll know, but if he doesn't, unlike me, he doesn't make it up, he'll go and find out. And so he's going to tell us, and this is a delayed lecture. We were going to have this program a while back, and Eric was busy taking care of some other things, so he's a great help, and here every Friday. And so the topic is really the bayou in our world and beyond. That's the title. But we're very fortunate to be able to be part of an interesting adventure that started with Allen Brothers and continued. Oh, I'm sorry.
Way before the Allen
Wait,
Brothers.
Well, all right, never mind. I'm going to let Eric tell you. Thank you very much for being here.
Thank you. Houston always operates under that mythology of those great real estate promoters, the Allen Brothers, but in truth, commerce had started on this bayou a decade and a half before they ever came here. And it's, we threw steps and moved along, but their major contribution was, were such promoters. And it's still going out there. In fact, I kind of think they're responsible for Texas's reputation in the East and the North for stretching the truth and blurring it a little bit. But anyway, this is my topic, vision of the bay, the bayou, our world, and beyond, promoting productivity, prosperity, and peace, and I credit support from many others. I really love this place. I've been in Houston for 12 years. I've been through the panhandle once before that. That's my total experience with Texas. But I immediately read a book on Texas history, and then I got involved with this place. And they have a wonderful staff. They're great to work with. They're very helpful and informative. Encouraging, so I like them, but I'm a Friday guy, like she says, and bring tours through on Fridays as they come, or individuals as they come, explain things that they want, but I learn as much from them as I tell them. Frequently, I learn things I never knew before. And I'm in the historical sense, they always refer to me as the in-house historian. I'm a historian in the sense that I don't write volumes and document infinite detail and all that. I just like big picture stories so I can understand how this all goes together, why it is what it is. So this talk really is about how we got from where this was just where the Lord left it. It was a bayou in a bay, and yeah, there were some Mexicans, but that was about it when it started developing along our bayou. And so this talk is about the visions that led to where we are, how we got there. As I told my wife, I'm completing my first year as an octogenarian. That means I'm an old fogey, and I have permission to say things the way I see them, and the rest of you are supposed to take that as wisdom. So anyway, here we go. Here's a couple of definitions of visions. Andrew Carnegie, who was the richest man in the world in his era, said, "All riches and all material things that anyone acquires through self-effort begin in the form of a clear, concise mental picture of the things one seeks." Personally, I think they start when that's all fuzzy, but you gotta define it and get it pretty clear and concise before you can really pursue it. But he did very well. He also said that any man that dies rich hasn't completed his life's duty. So he founded what's now Carnegie Mellon Institute and established more than 1,000 libraries around this country with his fortune. Then more current is Steve Jobs. His colleagues describe his reality distortion field as his ability to see what he wanted to see and then the will to make the delusion into truth. Now that's vision. And that's not done until you've done that. And most of his colleagues didn't understand his vision. They thought it was a delusion. But anyway, that's a good definition. I like that. So, next chart. Okay, there's only three resources you got to get from that vision to the final, where you get to the vision from the first light bulb. When I first was being promoted into a position to be responsible for a project and some people at GE 50 years ago, they had this course. It was a week long offsite. They ran those of us that were in that position through and had lots of things to teach you about, all things you're going to come up with that are beyond the technical things you came from. And then when you're all done, they gave you a bronze paperweight, which was very nice, and it sat on the desk for years. Somehow mine got disfigured and beat up, so I didn't move it to Houston. But anyway, on it, it had the three. Those are the only three resources you got to get where you want to go. You got people, which of course includes all the creativity and the planning and the effort to make it happen. You got time because there's processes that have sequence and you can't do them all at once. You got to do them as they need to flow. And the other thing is money. And what is money? It's the investment that you have, what you've saved from previous efforts and accomplishments. But that's what you got to work with when you go on. So I thought that was kind of an interesting point there. Then, so we start from, this was a bayou in a bay. And what was there? Somehow that jumped one. Oh, okay. These are some of the early visionaries that made it. John Richardson Harris and his brother William Plunkett Harris, 7 years younger. Those were the two guys that really started this way before the Allen brothers. They started it and got it going. Here's some of the early visions and the early visionaries. Vision Mexico had in setting up this land grant with the Austins was they wanted some Anglos in here to kind of provide a buffer between the Comanches and the other Indians that they were having some troubles with in their own settlements further south in Mexico. Moses Austin was a lead miner. He was a citizen of Mexico because he was mining lead in Mexican territory. What was Mexican territory at the time? And he negotiated this land grant with the Mexicans, but then he died, and his son Stephen took over, and that land grant was to move 300 families into this land grant. The Harris brothers, particularly John, knew Stephen up in just north of St. Louis on the Mississippi River. And John came down here immediately and started looking for the optimum place on Buffalo Bayou to start a town and start building a business. And he picked the point where the Buffalo Bayou was joined by the Breeze Bayou. Figured that was the best place on the whole thing, and that's where he started Harrisburg, and he plotted out the city in 1823. There, what's this thing? Yeah, 1823. So he established shipping on the bayou. Well, then there's William, his younger brother, 7 years younger, William Plunkett Harris. He came along, he was into shipping on the Mississippi, and he came along to help John with the transportation between here and New Orleans. And he had this vision of building railroads from Harrisburg to Austin and San Antonio and El Paso and on the way to San Diego. That was his vision. He never got to complete it, but he had that vision, and we'll get on to that. And then eventually the Allen brothers showed up, and their vision was to buy Harrisburg or establish and promote an alternative, and they pursued that. So anyway, those early visions and early visionaries who started this. So John Harris established Harrisburg in 1823. His first schooner was the Rights of Man. He was importing the settlers and their belongings and tools and supplies and things they needed. He built houses and docks and warehouse and store and saw grist mill and exported the products that these settlers came up with, which were cotton and sugar, two crops you rotate to save the soil some, and lumber, which there was lots of, and buffalo hides from trade with the Indians and whatever else. Here's the Cayuga. Now that was the first steamboat on the Buffalo Bayou. And this I got stole from a print in there that we have from the Harris Heirs. It's a copy from an oil painting they have. But they named it Cayuga after the town in upstate New York where the Harrises grew up. These Harrises were like fourth generation behind the Harris that was a partner of William Penn that settled Pennsylvania and established Harrisburg and named it in the honor of him. It was young people, but they named it in honor of the first Harris. So that's Harrisburg, and John here, 4 generations later, established Harrisburg here in Texas. Okay, then in 1835 and 36 came the rebellion. But it didn't work out the way the Mexicans wanted it, and it didn't work out the way the Anglos that came in wanted it. You know, Mexicans wanted more control and micromanaging, and the Texans wanted less of that and do what they wanted. And there was some difficulties with tariffs and so forth. And people got jailed and broke out of jail and that sort of thing. Anyway, by the end of 1835, there were no Mexicans in what is now Texas. But about that time, Santa Anna came along and declared himself dictator of Mexico. And he thought that all those people that live in Texas were Mexicans because they were in Mexico. And that was part of the agreement in his mind. And if they were taking up arms against Mexican military, then they were traitors and deserved to be shot. And that was his approach to the whole thing. So he came back early in 1836, and it was the big battle at the Alamo that you all know about. I'm going to follow up one in Goliad, but while the Battle of Alamo was going on, the leaders of the Texas Rebellion were meeting Washington on the Brazos and taking the U.S. Constitution and Declaration of Independence and rewriting them a bit to fit what they wanted for Texas. And Sam Houston was there, and he wanted to go off and help the Alamo guys, but they said, wait till we get this done. They got it done in a hurry. But unfortunately, by the time they got it done, the Alamo had folded. And Santa Ana, having heard that this was going on, decided it was time to go get them. So he started with his large army coming for this group, and that led to the event called the Runaway Scrape. And that was when most of the Anglos in Texas headed through Arkansas or Louisiana, heading back for the U.S. to avoid running into Santa Ana. And the group of leaders that wrote up the Texas Constitution, the temporary officers that were appointed at that time, all came through Harrisburg, and in advance of Santa Ana. And John Harris's widow, who was here by then, let them use her house to meet him. She stayed evenings across the bayou at a friend's house. But anyway, that was where that was. And then Santa Ana started closing in. And so all those Texas leaders got on the Cayuga and took some other people that were there and took them over to Anahuac and set them on their way. And then they came back to Harrisburg to pick up a couple of other people. And they managed to clear Harrisburg just as Santa Ana's advance team came into town. They were about a rifle shot off the banks when they got there. So they got away. But there was a 3-week period in there when the cabinet was on the Cayuga, and it got the name as the floating capital of Texas. It went on down the bay to Galveston and was there when the battle happened at San Jacinto. Santa Ana came along behind this, and before he left Harrisburg, he burned it to the ground, except for one house that was kind of out on the edge of town. And then he went on to San Jacinto and noticed that the Sam Houston, who had been delaying confrontation as long as he could, I putting thoughts in his mind, suppose in part he was getting his army to learn to work together and be teamwork and waiting for their emotions to get fired up. So he got them in the battlefield down there, so their backs were against the water, and they put a line of all their luggage and their mules and their two cannons and so forth, and kind of made a barricade. And Santa Ana and his group came in and saw they were kind of have to be right there where they are, but let's just camp and rest for a couple of days, and then we'll tear apart. So that's what they did. But the next day, Houston called a staff meeting with his leaders, and they had a debate, started about noon, about start making plans of how we're going to attack here. And he had lost his ability to hold them down. They were, now, let's go. And they did. And the Mexicans hadn't expected it, so they got badly beaten at that battle. Again, that was April 21st, 1836. Here's pictures of Sam Houston and Santa Ana. Those are online. You go online, see that? My sources of research here, well, we got a good library upstairs, and I use that. And then I use all these other knowledgeable guys that support this place, and the other docents and the leaders, and hey! see, family in the back. But I learn a lot from the people that come through here, and then I go searching online for Google will help you find a lot more. And there's lots of Google pictures of Sam Houston in there, and not very many of Santa Ana. But anyway, Houston had 910 men. He had two cannons, which were a gift from the people of the city of Cincinnati. At that point, the center of the iron industry in the world was in Cincinnati. They donated a couple of cannons to this battle. So they had two cannons. Santa Ana only had one, but he had 1,360 men in his one cannon. So when the Texans attacked, the battle lasted 15 minutes. There were 11 Texans killed and 30 wounded. Santa Ana's 1,360, 650 of them were killed, 280 were wounded, and 300 were captured. So it was a total wipeout for the Mexicans, and that freed Texas and established Texas as a separate republic. This is a picture painted 50 years later. An oil painting of the Battle of San Jacinto. It hangs in the Senate office in the state capitol in Austin, and it's kind of interesting. So then after this, then the Allen brothers came along. And they were great promoters, and they had money. I'm not sure how much of it was theirs and how much of it were backers. I researched that. But they came at the end of 1836 and discovered that when John Harris died, his family and his business partners got in a big disagreement of who inherited what. And it got into the courts, and then after the Texans won their independence, so now you got a contested will in the hands of sets of lawyers from two different countries. I don't think that was a problem. So that's what the Allen brothers ran into in Harrisburg. And the other thing was the town was burnt down except for one house. John Harris's widow had got hers half rebuilt using captured Mexican soldiers, guys that burned it down in the first place to help her build it. But that's all there was to the town at that point. So they realized that wasn't going to work. They came to one of those forks in the road where you got to take another approach. So the next year, they came back and tried again. So Allen's Texas brag or hype was Houston, the real estate of promotion. They claimed, well, they established the town, and they laid out a grid for streets and lots and blocks and things, and announced to the world that was the head of navigation. Of course, the way they got there was they came upstream on the Laura. That was okay, which was a small steamboat, and it was all right to Harrisburg, but then they had to winch from tree to tree, clear out the deadfalls, cut the trees that were hanging across the water. That's 6 miles, and it took them quite a long time to do it. So they came here in January 1837 on the Laura. And later that year, they pulled another stunt. They paid the skipper of the Constitution, a larger steamboat that regularly steamed on the ocean between Galveston and Louisiana. They paid him $1,000. That's $1,018.37, which is a bit bigger than current poppers. And what they paid him for was to winch that ocean-going ship up the bayou all the way to Houston, and they had to winch it tree to tree, around all the bends and so forth, till they got it there. And then they could take a picture and they could write the press about how they had it. It was the head of navigation, and they got ocean shipping in Houston. And that was about as close as they ever really got. But then, in order to get the Constitution out of there, they had to winch it back down the through the bayou the same way. And when they got it down to a wide spot in the bend, big bend, where the bayou had widened out some, then they could manage to turn it around and head it downstream from there. And that bend was known for the next 50 years as Constitution Bend. But anyway, this was all part of Allen's promotion. They talked about the salubrious climate and rolling terrain and no mention of the 100 plus degrees of temperature and humidity, and nothing talking about the mosquitoes and the alligators and snakes and the yellow fever and the hurricanes and the floods and so forth. But it seemed to work, because the city grew, and eventually in 1914, Constitution Bend was renamed the Turning Basin, because that's as far as the people that were doing the pitching and straightening in 1914 figured it was worthwhile trying to go, because it got too narrow, too windy, too. Let's just do it here, and they made a turning basin there, and that's where. So the Port of Houston never was in Houston until about 1924, 5, 6, somewhere in there, they annexed Harrisburg. And then it became, the ship channel became part of Houston. Then they changed the name again, another time. Anyway, here's the Laura. Right? I take things where I can find them. That's a picture of Bert's miniature diorama of the Laura in the next room in there. And this is a painting that was first published in Matilda Houston's Texas and the Gulf of Mexico is the name of it, in 1844. And, you know, it has hills. I suspect on a scale, that's a good deal wider than the bayou really was. It has trains in here. Well, the first successful train, first laid track, and first got a locomotive in 1841. So it's possible by this point there was something, but not quite as many as showing that picture. But anyway, this apparently was published and spread around the world for a long time. And you gotta give the Houstonians something. They have a big vision and they make the most of it and they go. So anyway, talking about railroads, William Plunkett Harris, when he was in Harrisburg, he envisioned a railroad from Harrisburg to San Diego. That was his vision. Now, he never got to do it because things got in the way, and he eventually left Harrisburg, and after the revolution, he ended up running the customs house in down in Galveston, and then eventually went back to Louisiana. There were at least four railroads chartered that didn't start until we got to the fourth one. The BBB&C, Buffalo Bayou, Brazos, and Colorado, started in 1841. It was called the BBB&C, or the Harrisburg Railroad. And it kind of inched its way westward up until the Civil War started in 1861, and that kind of stopped it near Columbus, heading for Austin. Well, by the end of the war, people of Columbus went out and laid track from where it stopped into Columbus so they would not get bypassed, which I guess was a fairly common approach to, we want the railroad, you know, where's your wind? And eventually, that was merged into the Southern Pacific in 1883, and eventually that became the second transcontinental railroad. It was about 14 years after the Golden Spike on the Union Pacific and Central Pacific further north. But anyway, that fulfilled that dream of our vision plucked at Harris. This is the first locomotive they had. He named it General Sherman. Sherman was a hero of that. Whoa, where'd my things go? Where's?
You need some help?
Yeah, I need some help. I lost my... Well, there it is, maybe.
That?
Well, we'll see. I don't know what happened to it. Yeah. Okay. There it is. There it is. Yeah. Well, first part of it.
I'll get the camera.
Yeah, get the our tech expert. The U.S. railroads, all the majors, in 2010. And you notice if you go down here to where Houston is, you find there's 9 major railroad lines coming through there. If you look at the spread, you'll notice there's only a few that go across the Rocky Mountains here. But if you go from Houston, you're connected on up through St. Louis and Kansas City and all the way up into Chicago over here. So anyway, all to the east and east to the west and even up into Canada up here, just illustrating the point that by now our port is totally tied into the whole middle of the country. There we go. Charles Morgan came along. He bought the Bayou Ship Channel Company in 1874. That was one of its 5 names it's had in the course of history. And he was a shipping magnate and did a lot of ocean shipping, and he wanted to get his ocean freight up into the bayou without having to transship it at Galveston and pay Galveston's monopoly rates. So he proceeded to dredge a deeper ditch and a wider ditch from Galveston to the present Clinton, which is essentially Harrisburg, in that area. And he made the first cut to shorten the path. There's a picture of that in the next room. They called it Morgan's Cut. But his competitors were all cheering because that was going to get them free from Galveston too. But he said, well, yeah, but we're going to put a chain across it and you're going to pay toll to use it. You're going to help us pay for the cost. So we got all this started. The first ocean vessels came in on September 26, 1876. And then Morgan shifted his attention to his railroads, of which he had several. And this one passed into other hands. Okay. Dredging continues worldwide. There's always maintenance of channels on silt and erosion and deepening and widening as the ships get bigger and the loads get heavier. This one here is a picture I took in Vietnam, Ho Chi Minh City port, and that was full of dredges. And the interesting thing there, they were maintaining the channel through this big widespread area, but they were also digging up sand which they could put on barges and send up to the concrete companies and sell it to them to build Ho Chi Minh City that was becoming a modern city after the Vietnamese War. This one is a picture right out of the port report this month, and it was labeled Barber's Cut Channel Completed. So I put that in there because that's right up to the minute, dredging for the bigger ships that will be coming up from the bigger Panama Canal. So then we go to intermodal transportation. Container transport of freight, you know, in multiple loads, that's the definition of intermodal, rail, ship, truck, whatever else, without handling the freight itself, just the containers. And it's faster, it's more secure, it's less damage. And one of the places I looked said it dates to the Bridgewater Canal coal containers in 1780s. Personally, I thought, well, we got one of these amphoras out front. I think it dates back to that, you know? But anyway, it was also a thing in there talking about U.S. lift vans in 1911, which were used to transport coal in vans. And then when World War II came along, the military soon insisted that everything that could be palleted rather than use forklifts, rather than the old-fashioned hook and the stevedore or whatever to move everything. So that's part of the way it starts. Now, yeah, well, this one popped in here too. 1844, this is a picture in a museum in Munich of the French mail in 1844. They had it set up so they could take the coach body off the coach wheels and put them on the railroad truck, or vice versa. So the idea has been around for quite a while with many variations on it. But as we know it now, the first container ship was by Malcolm McLean. Malcolm McLean and his brother and sister had built the largest trucking company in the country. And Malcolm got thinking about how he could help facilitate all that and came up with the idea that he needed to have a standard container that you could use on ships, on trains, on trucks, and not have to unload and reload. So his first ship left the port of Elizabeth, had 58 35-foot containers on it for 58 trucks. So at that point in time, the handling cost per ton of freight had been $5.86. That time they dropped it to 16 cents, which is a major change. And it had a direct input, you know, commensurate site time savings in the port, and faster, more profitable shipping, and it opened us up to more products from more distant sources and more distant markets. And so it had a major step forward in how production or transportation went. And that came out of the book, The Box, which is a fascinating book if you're interested in that subject. I went online and I said, give me a picture of the biggest container ship in the world now. Well, what they told me was in the last 5 years, there have been more than 100 ships launched that at the time of their launch claimed to be the biggest container ship in the world. So it's obviously the length of what anybody held the title was average a week and a half or something. It wasn't very long. But anyway, I picked out this picture of a Maersk ship. This was a triple E design, economies of scale, energy efficient, environmentally improved, and it had 18,270 TEUs, equivalent 20-foot containers, which is the measure that's used, launched in 13. So it's certainly not the biggest. Now they've gotten them up to 20,000 TEUs. But the interesting thing about this, you read a little deeper, and all this efficiency and so forth doesn't work unless the thing is fully loaded, you know. Otherwise, they're wasting energy just carrying a lesser load and it doesn't come off as good. Okay, and this is another picture right out of a Port of Houston report. and it points out that container volumes continue to surge, and this port served by the Burlington Northern Santa Fe and the Union Pacific, which are the two of the majors that run out of command in this area. And almost 150 motor free lines. So it's a big thing, still going and still growing. Now, of course, there's a lot of impact on people when you get the politicians crying and weeping about what that does to the little guy on the bottom. Well, yeah, but he saw more than anybody else. And everybody has to find a new skills and a new way of playing. But you look up the line, the investors and bankers sure got to change their habits and where they put their money, because they stick with the old and they're going to go broke. And the managers and professionals and software and other techs all got to build new planning and control systems to handle all this. And then the masters and mates on the ship have to learn new ways to balance freight in their ships, plan for efficient loading and unloading sequences, and how to manage that. So everybody gets impacted when these technology things come along. And nobody ever mentions this one. And that is every one of them benefits because they get access to a wider variety of products and they're cheaper. So, yeah, they're forced to learn new skills. There's a payoff for everybody. Maybe not what you wanted, but it's what you get. Okay, this is the Rickmer's Dallium. This is a heavy lift ship. This was 2 football fields long. It's got 4 cranes of its own on it. The Rickmer's it's a German outfit, been building ships and hauling freight for 190 years. This is a ship Sarah and I went around the world on 4 years ago now. 4 years ago, we were just about to come home. One of the interesting things about this, as far as promoting peace, prosperity, and so forth, is a cross-cultural cooperation. That ship had 25 souls aboard. Officers, crew, passengers, 25 souls from 8 countries, US, Canada, France, Norway, Poland, Philippines, Romania, and China. Had 2 messes, the officers' mess and the crew mess. Well, in fact, it had the officer's mess, and the crew's mess was really the Filipino mess. The cook for all of this was a Filipino. And you found that Filipinos that rose up through the ranks and became officers ate in the Filipino mess rather than the officer's mess, unless they really needed to talk to the captain over a meal or something. And even my Brian here, who's a foodie, found that she liked that Filipino mess, and sometimes that food was more appealing to her. They always had wonderful rice cooking all the time. So anyway, there's people from all those different backgrounds. There was a sign in the officer's mess that said the official language of commercial shipping and this dining room is English. And you would find all those people that ate in that room like to talk to us and practice a bit. And it was very interesting because, you know, some of them, the only contact they'd ever had with English was what's on TV and then third-rate movies and so forth. And yeah, well, you're not like that. No, we're typical. So anyway, that was a very interesting thing. Okay. In the fighting sail room there's a model of Old Ironsides. And this is Old Ironsides' main sail on the main mast. And on this yardarm, they're furling this sail, and there's 23 people handling that sail. Whereas we had 23 people sailing this ship, modern ship, that carried $1 billion on it much of the time. Products and things. And there's another measure of efficiency, what the world has brought us to. Okay, here's one of the most powerful vision statements I know of. This is Jimmy Doolittle, 4 months after Pearl Harbor, took a fleet of Air Force B-25s, taught them how to land on a carrier and take off of a carrier. And got on a carrier and headed for Japan. Unfortunately, they wanted to get close, but unfortunately the clouds parted and some Japanese plane flew over, so they knew they were discovered. And so they took off early, and they didn't have fuel enough to get back, but they were bombing the industrial parks of Japan. They hit 5 city areas, and then headed for China, where they ran out of fuel. Of course, a few of them got shot down and got captured by the Japanese. One of them even flew on over and ended up in Russia. Russia didn't give them back until after the war was over. And I think that's a real vision statement to let us know and let the Japanese know that we're going to win this thing. Okay, what else happened during the Second World War? 1942, they founded the Brown Shipbuilding Company here in Houston. And between May of 43 and August of 45, they built 208 Liberty ships, 61 destroyer escorts, 254 LSMs. I guess some of those are called boats because by the war end it said it produced 350 ships. Well, some of those are probably called boats. Anyway, whatever, the numbers don't quite add up. But anyway, they had Navy contracts amounting to $500 million. And after the war, at the end of the war, they were making some tankers, but they sold that to Todd Shipbuilding, and it closed down in 1985, and used by Brown and Root for barge work, and then broke up and sold pieces in 2004. Here's the SS John W. Brown. This is one of the Liberty ships. There are 3 of those still in existence in the world, one in San Francisco, and one in the East Coast, and one in Europe. One in San Francisco, I think, still cruises a little bit. The others are museum ships. But those were a key to the whole Second World War for us to supply ourselves in Europe and Russia and the whole war in the Pacific. The next one is this, Samuel B. Roberts. This one was built here in the Battle of Leyte Gulf. The Japanese came in and we were having trouble with our landing plans, and they pulled the Navy out of there, and they left a small group in Leyte Gulf. For several days they had to handle the Japanese by themselves, and this one got the name of the destroyer escort that fought like a battleship. But it was made right here. The next one, this is a Tarascon. This is a gasoline tanker built by Todd Houston in the summer of 45, right at the end of the war. It was around for a while. Anyway, the fulfillment of this vision was the Japanese surrender on board the Missouri, the Mighty Mo, which is the last of the big battleships. And that kind of concluded that war. The Mighty Mo fought through the Korean War, the Vietnam War, the first Gulf War, but now it's a museum ship in Hawaii also. Okay. A couple of key drivers for productivity, prosperity, and peace. Money. You need money. And what is that? Well, money or wealth is nothing but human creativity, effort, and frugality held in a transferable form, usable anywhere for daily needs and anticipated future or investing in your visions. That's a key thing, and everybody around the world recognizes money in the exchange rates, which nowadays comes down to tits in a computer, but rather than gold, but still people recognize and accept it and accept exchange rates and so forth. And that's what it is. It's just a storehouse of what you've already accomplished that you can apply to the new vision. Trade is another thing that's always tended to unite people around the world. Because if I got something you want and you got something I want, we can either barter or trade for money. And we don't have to like each other or anything else about each other, except you got some of my mind. So when people talk about peace, they frequently don't recognize. Here's a couple of the basics, guys. You know? Anyway, I had to throw that in there. So now look at the visions in the oil industry, which is the biggest single industry here in Houston now. The first oil well was drilled in Titusville, Pennsylvania, 1859, to a whole depth of 69 feet. Motivation for that was discovering that you could get kerosene out of these petroleum oil seeps, and that you could use that in your lamps instead of whale oil, and it was getting cheaper than the whale oil was and more readily available. And then their research types had figured out how to burn it so it didn't create as much soot or smell as bad, and so it was taken off. And that was one of the drivers behind this well, which was the first. The next one, which many people don't realize, was the Sutherland Oil Company. This was the world's first offshore oil wells. They were drilled from piers in south of Santa Barbara, 10 miles or so. And it was richly productive, it says, producing over 3 million barrels of oil over a 50-year time period. And it was finally closed down in 1940. And that was a very productive thing. But then along came Spindletop in 1901, the Lucas Gusher. And in its first part of a year, it put out 3.5 million barrels. That's more than 50 years out of Sutherland. In the second year, they multiplied that by 5 and got 17.4 million barrels of oil. In this oil field and its result of them started Gulf and Chevron and Texaco and Amoco and Humboldt and Exxon. It's a major thing. And it's down here in southeast Texas, so the bayou shipping became an obvious place to try to transport it and build your refineries and so forth. So it expanded, you know, railroads, autos, Daimler, and Benz in Germany invented the internal combustion engine, as well as, all the steam engines before that had external combustion and created steam, and you put the steam in the engine. Well, these guys figured out, put the gasoline in the engine, not have all that extra stuff. So anyway, it was a major driver, and it came along at the right time. And then lots of other high-tech energies supported a lot of businesses and growth. And so Houston has become the world energy capital. It is home to the world's largest petrochemical cluster, with 5,000 energy-related firms, 33 on the Fortune 1000 list, and ExxonMobil, for instance, consumed consistently near the top. 27 Texas refiners lead the U.S. crude production and refining, which is 28.8% of the U.S. total capacity. Now, I must tell you that every number in here changes monthly, daily, weekly. So if you really want up-to-date numbers, go do your own research. It will all change. But anyway, the average wage in those industry for the high energy technical workers are like $95,000 a year for 100,000 high energy workers. And at the point where it was 40% of the U.S. oil base. Here's a picture of Exxon Baytown, the largest in the U.S., puts out more than 500 million barrels a day, eighth in the world. Here's a list of 144 of the products that come out of Houston's oil products. That's 144 out of more than 6,000. And I've kind of randomly highlighted a few that there's one, heart valves, crayons, dishes, ice chests, shoes, fishing lures. I mean, you know, there's all kinds of stuff on there. But that's only the the top.
Yeah.
Okay. Oops, double. Port volume. These are the major import and export products. And you notice there's certain similarities. Oil, seamless, iron tubes, steel pipes, gasoline, other fuels. Motor vehicles. Do you know that every Volkswagen, Porsche, and Audi that is made, not made in the United States, is imported through Houston? There's another business that's got a big hit recently, probably. But that's one of the major ones. Exports, again, they're mainly petroleum-based things, so it says heavy machine parts. And I can't give you an explanation of what that is, other than when we came back into the port on our trip around the world, there was a line of 100 tractors being rolled onto a railroad ship that were coming out of the U.S. The top trading partners in the first 4 months of this year were these, headed by China and Mexico, and then Brazil and Germany, and South Korea and Netherlands, Colombia and Venezuela, and Belgium and Italy. Those were the top producers. So here we get into some pictures that, and a little bit into the offshore oil stuff. There's some good pictures here. I love this one, this Thunder Horse semi-submersible. This one on the left is showing you working on building that thing, nighttime, lights all over the place. And eventually they moved it out to its site. I'm not going to go real deep into these things because next week's speaker will. But I need to touch on it. There's a modern drill ship and drilling among the icebergs, which Shell this month has decided is a little bit too expensive for a $50 petroleum. But anyway, here's one of these floating production storage offshore where you take the oil out of an underwater well and separate the oil and water and the gas and so forth, and ships will come along, tankers take it in, and that those are used where they're too few to justify building a whole pipeline to them. This one, it's a modern oil tanker. It's Libertyville Bay, built in 2014, Philadelphia. Again, $200 million cost, 115,000 deadweight tons, or 33 million gallons per trip. Deepwater Horizon, we're all kind of familiar with that and the fact that it had a failure and what came from that. It's interesting. Some of the facts about it are interesting too, though. It's drilled well in water that was 0.8 miles deep, and it drilled a well 7 miles deep. And those are record kinds of numbers. But unfortunately, they had a blowout that killed a bunch of men and 11 crewmen from a huge oil spill, the largest we ever had. This is a big bop, a blowout preventer, and that's what failed to prevent the blowout. And hopefully we learned a lot more about designing men than they knew at that time. And this here, this is an amazing thing. This is the kind of big structure you'll hear about next week. This thing's on two barges with this big frame over it. Here's a crane claw that can go down and grab wreckage and stuff off the bottom and pull it up. And for scale, there's one of those large support ships in front of it. Now here's a couple of my resources that I hadn't mentioned. All those pictures I just went through were given to me by Lawrence Schallenberger, who's been 50 years in that industry. And the ones that follow on are ones that Bill Rose gave me. Both of these guys are museum trustees and docents. And I violated the custom of our culture of going from left to right, because if I put Lawrence on the left and Milt on the right, it would look like Lawrence is gunning for Milt. So we better just change that. I don't know what ever happened with that blunderbuss. It was around at one time. Anyway, workbench boats. Milt gave me some information on this. And the brown water fleet is, everything is not blue water. In other words, it doesn't really go to sea for the most part. But it's all the harbor tugs and the barges and the towboats and the ferries and so forth. And the huge offshore supply vessels also are, that's another industry that Milt was involved in the last part of his career. And then, of course, the seagoing tugs and support vessels. And then there's special purpose ones like the fireboats. Here's the another illustration of how well positioned our port is for shipping throughout the country. This is the U.S. inland waterway system. And you notice it reaches down here to the very tip of Texas. And then there's Houston. And then it goes over to Louisiana and New Orleans. And then it goes up the Mississippi with branches on the Missouri and the Arkansas and the Red River and the Illinois River. Takes it over to Chicago and the Great Lakes. We're tied in there. And of course, the Ohio River goes all the way up to Pennsylvania. And there's the Tennessee River and the Alabama River and so forth. So we're really tied to the whole middle of the country for the with the boats too. And Kirby's is apparently the largest towboat company in the country. Harbor tugs, you've all seen those if you've been in a harbor. Those are the small ones that push the big ships around, help them turn around, maneuver into their dock positions and pull them out, keep them in the stream as needed. The pilots claim it's their most valuable asset. Then we come to, here's the offshore seagoing tugs. Those are much larger and more powerful than harbor tugs. These have engines as big as that ship we went around the world in, and they got power, and they can tow things, and they can tow ships and marine structures off really long distances, important in salvage work. Here's the fast support vessel, like Milt had a fleet of. Speeds up to 30 knots. Don't get anxious. Here's one in front of some jackup rigs. I call the supply vessel here, but they do it with similar boats. So then, a couple other things that come in here, visions that are seen and we need to address more. One of them is this report hit the Houston Chronicle in August for the Galveston Bay Health. And so the overall grade was a C. We got a B for water quality, but then we got C's and D's and an incomplete on the other things they looked at. So we got something to do. And it says, without continued action, the health of the bay will continue to deteriorate. And I put that slide together back in August. And one of the things I added was this little blue line at the bottom that says air coming on this. My nose tells me we need to address that sometime. And then in the last few weeks, the EPA came out and said, we've been soft on you guys long enough. You need to step up and make a step towards that. So I agree with that. It's not always the happiest thing to have to face up that you really need to address something because it's going to cost us something. Another thing that we need to address is the reality of flooding. We've got to embrace it and learn to live with it. We've had 8 storms in the recent years that had 13 inches in a 24-hour period. 25% of Houston lies within that area, which is officially designated the 100-year official standard. Well, 8 storms in a few couple of decades hardly is a 100-year standard, is it? It's higher than that. What's even worse is there have been 3 storms in the last 40 years where we got 19 inches in 24 hours, which is the official 500-year standard. So we 3 and 40 years, while we weren't all exactly the same spot, but they weren't that far apart. Clearly, we need to think about that some. We need to respect our floodplains. We need to figure out how we're going to buy out and close out the things that are too close to the bayous and control the upstream development so we don't pave county after county and have it all come flooding down here when it rains. And then focus on ways of simply supplying info and evacuation when necessary. So training and education, one of the things come out of all this, and this is one of the functions that we take on here in the museum, but you know, jobs and financial opportunities don't diminish with economic development. They change and they spread, and there's more of them. In fact, every job that's cut is replaced by more than one, different, but more than one. They require new skills, so yes, what's that tell us? And maritime history says this over and over again as you look back through it. So we all need to plan on a lifetime of learning and preparation for and looking at where the future seems to be going. And if we want to achieve, maximize our prosperity and lifetime satisfaction, we need to keep ourselves trained. Okay, Maritime Museum exhibit opportunities. When I look around here, every single thing we've displayed in this museum can be related to other things in this museum, or other things we need to acquire to build stories as parts of the exhibits. And they can be temporary or permanent or shared, you know, for education and entertainment, building on a free exchange of ideas, and for understanding the diversity of businesses, cultures, and people. That's one of the things I think. So, next to the last slide here, Jim Manzalillo's initial collection and his vision have brought us a long ways along the road to where it forks and broadens. And we've got this place stuffed to the gills, and got rid of all the marginal stuff, and have more stuff in storage than we can display. And we need to do something about that. Maritime Museum's vision is to be Houston's showplace of maritime heritage and commerce through education programs, interactive exhibits, and related events. And there's where the road changes problems. Anyway, here's the vision for the new Houston Maritime Museum from the architects. At this point, we'll talk about that. I'll turn it over to our director, Leslie. Unless there's other questions on any of the other things I showed you.
So we've gotten the location, the design, construction, we've got some banking, we're working on funding, and working on the exhibit design. So we are looking at, hopefully, plan is to break ground in late spring, and 14-month to 16-month construction schedule, something like that. So that's our timeline, that's what we hope to accomplish. We'll probably, I'm thinking in January, I'm not sure yet of the date, but we'll probably do a whole presentation in January with the details and the floor plans, and you guys can all see what we're going to be doing in detail. So, does anyone have any questions for Eric? Because I don't want to let him get away without answering all of your thoughts.
If there are any.
You know, you can come on Fridays and talk to him and ask him about all the things that you
told him. I'm afraid you are.
Yeah.
take you around and dig in where you'd like to.
So, of the 23 sailors on the main sail on the iron sides, how many in the whole ship?
I think that at the time it was launched, it was like 250. But, of course, it had 50 guns on it, and that takes a lot of people. I mean, every gun takes 4 or 5 people to handle it optimum way. I'm getting away with fewer sometimes. And usually we're firing this side and that side. But yeah, like 250 total people.
The mass of how huge the maritime world is what I think we have such a hard time grasping. It's incredible. And it's so, I mean, all I think of is, wow, how did this happen? And then now we've got 23 guys sailing a ship. It's totally
well,
amazing.
And Maersk has a reputation for having the minimum crew. And they sail some of these biggest container ships in the world with crews down to 11, 12. I mean, they're total, to do away with the engineers, because all of that's automated. They got, you know, they got to have three officers, three watches. They got three officers. They got three men to be the lookouts with them. So that's 6. And they need at least 1 cook. You know, good stuff. Maersk has that reputation. Most of the others have 20 kind of things. It's a big change.
Everything has changed, and actually, you took us from the very beginning to. We went through all of the changes, and I'm sure we'll have an update soon. I'm sure we'll have lots more going on.
I didn't pick every industry, but some of the key ones.
Thank you very much, Eric. Well, we will see you all hopefully next week for our Doc Wise lecture, and then next month for Chase Unschmeyer. About his new book.